It's 4 o'clock on a Monday, and you know what that means. Yep, it's time for another exciting episode of Taxi TV Live. This week, starring special guest star, Miss Robin Frederick. Yeah, baby! No, I can't say, yeah, baby, on live news. I'll be on the news or something. Anyway.
Can I get a close-up on that, though? Where's the cameraman?
Anyway, welcome to the show. Hi, Robin.
It's my pleasure to be here. I love doing the show.
That's fine.
Where's your chat room thing?
There it is. Hello, audience. Yeah, there you guys are. Let's see who we've got. Score Crazy, Piano, Guitar, Vocal. Hello. Let's see. Peter Rahill, Amanda, Gloria, William Andrew.
I see lots of names. People I know.
Jean,
nice to see everybody.
Genevieve Reed.
Come to the road rally and say hi to me when you're there, by the way, everybody.
Yes, which, by the way, it's coming up just 2 weeks from Thursday, November 3rd through the 6th. I don't know if you guys saw the email that went out on Saturday, but it links you to a page of everything you need to know about the road rally, from the panels in the Grand Ballroom to the genre-specific listening panels upstairs in the Concourse Ballroom, to one-to-one mentors, to, let's see, mentor lunches, which you can buy tickets by clicking a button there. What else do we have? One-to-one mentors, did I mention those? Just all kinds of good stuff. Anyway, an amazing road rally. I know, because I've been sitting here every weekend working on it. And don't forget that on... where are you? Going backwards. Oops, my pages are out of order. Robin... is going to do a thing.
Saturday at 11.
Yes.
My normal time, yeah.
A thing called being contemporary. We were talking about this just before we went on the air. And, you know, there's so much more about being contemporary than just production. So mm-hmm. Robin is going to make you keenly aware of that.
I got some great examples to play. It'll be a lot of fun. You're going to laugh at some of them and some of the oldies and some new stuff. And you can really hear the difference. I'm demonstrate it for you so you can really hear the difference.
She told me about one of the examples or two of the examples she's using to demonstrate one thing. And it's going to be awesome. So make sure you're there in the Grand Ballroom at 11 o'clock on Saturday, 11 o'clock to 12 o'clock. I had a list of other stuff I wanted to get to. Here, I'll show you. I don't know if this is going to read very well on camera, but this is a photo I found over the weekend of the very first road rally in 1997. So that was 20 years ago. We actually had about 350 people, and this was taken on Sunday afternoon before a lot of people had flown home already, but that was the lingering crowd and pretty awesome. Here, I'll scare you with this little road rally memory. Whoops. There's Pat Boone.
Oh, in a heavy metal mood, he was.
Yes, he was. And Michael Lloyd and myself both looking considerably younger. That was probably 10 or 12 years ago.
That was your Bono period.
Yeah. Yeah. And one more very quickly. Randy Bachman, Mr. Taking Care of Business at the Road Rally. That was probably 15 years ago. Anyway, it will be our 20th road rally, and worked really, really hard to make it kind of special. Not that they're not always special.
Always,
but
always.
This year, I tried even harder, and I think that we've done it. So, want to mention Robin's book, Shortcuts to Songwriting for Film and TV. Somebody suggested to me the other day, or told me that they were going to buy it and then read it on the plane on the way out. I'm assuming they're coming from Europe, because... It's loaded with stuff. But, you know, I actually thought that was a really good idea because this way he can acquaint himself with the issues that he would like to know more about and maybe have questions for you at your booth when he stops by.
Oh, yeah,
or
definitely.
Just generally orient himself for different things at the road rally based on
and before
all
you go
stuff.
To the music supervisor panels and things, or what songs you're going to bring.
Or pitch,
that's what I mean. And if you already have the book, I would definitely, you know, refresh yourself on that before you come and select the songs that you want to be pitching to those panels. See how close you can get to something that they want.
That's a great idea. And also, go to Taxi, write this down. Go to taxi.com/rally, and that will take you to a page that's probably got like a dozen different buttons that breaks down every little aspect of the rally. We are updating those pages as we get more mentors that give us updated bios and things like that. But it's like 98% accurate at this point. The mentor lunches will be on Friday and Saturday. They're $33 a piece. We don't make any money on that. It's just a pass-through to the hotel. They will fill up probably a week before the rally. So we haven't even done an email promoting them yet, but just because the button's up on the page, we're probably close to 100 out of 300 seats being sold out for each of those days already. The hotel, $133 night discount. We sold out of 1,347 rooms, I think. And the rooms are now like 169, and they put you on the executive level or something. But I will tell you that I looked over the weekend, and the rooms were up to $222 without the taxi discount, or $224. So the discount is still really good. That's it. So now what we're going to do today is Robin is going to listen to a half a dozen songs that we've got that producer Kimberly picked from the stuff you guys submitted online. One other quick thing. We, for some of the door prizes we're giving away this year, we're actually going to do it via Twitter, because every year I sit there on stage pulling ticket stub after ticket stub after ticket stub, and it just eats into, sorry, I got an itchy nose, eats into the ballroom time, and or I mean the panel time. So this year what we're going to do is when everybody's in the room and seated, we're going to say, okay, get ready to tweet hashtag Taxi Road Rally, I'm in the Robin Frederick panel. And when they do it, the first person that shows up on somebody's phone from the staff, that person will get the prize.
Okay.
Yeah, so hopefully that will be...
get your Twitter fingers going really fast now. Practice.
You know, you can have it ready to go and just hit bink, when we say 3, 2, 1, go. So if you don't have Twitter on your phone or iPad, get it. That's about it for now. So let us begin with the listening. This is my best Colonel Klink imitation. For those of you old enough to know who Colonel Klink was. Whoops. Let's try that again. This one is called Nothing in This World. And this week, we're not dealing with... I don't know. Should I mention the names? Yeah, what the hell. Because nobody's feelings are going to be hurt in this show. This is Nothing in This World, done by Clark Van Norris. Hello, Clark.
So we're thinking film and TV here.
Oh, yes.
Is this going to work for film and TV? Great opening, Clark.
Sparky. Somebody said call everybody named Clark Sparky, so I just did.
Okay.
That's how much we love our audience.
It's a really good song, really good. I'm sure, I think probably everybody would agree on this one. I don't think there's a library that would turn this down. I think most music supervisors would be really interested in holding on to it. Certainly for a show like Rain, where they use this kind of indie folk, even though it's anachronistic to the show, they use it anyway. And it works really well for any kind of upbeat scene. Lyrically, it's a really good example of a universal lyric.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's focused on, here's the emotion in a moment. If I have this feeling right now that if you and I were always together, we could do everything. We could do anything. Nothing could stop us. In this moment, that's how I'm feeling. And it just stays with that moment the whole way through. It's a great example of a good universal lyric. How do you not tell stories? You know, how do you not travel through time? How do you avoid doing what the script is doing? And that's what this song does really well. Focusing on what it feels like in that moment to say, this is how I'm feeling. And then it perfectly underscores and enhances a scene that has that feeling in it. It's really good. I hesitate to say anything. It's an indie folk genre, obviously. It goes right into that Mumford & Sons vibe, which is really popular with film and television. And if I were going to say anything, and I don't think you need to change anything, but I would have lengthened the bridge and given it a little bit more. Melodically, it had some good contrast with what came before, but lyrically, it was just a repetition. There's nothing in this world that we can't do. And then slightly different, If It's You and Me Standing Side by Side was a little bit different. But and it said, it came right out and said it, you and me standing side by side, which is good. But I probably would add two more lines to that bridge just to stay away a little bit longer from the song and then plunge back into your breakdown. And then at the very end, as you go out, it seemed to lose some energy and lose some focus on the very end with, you have a nice little bum, 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 but we've heard it a few times. I would probably have brought in an instrument to solo over that, whether it would be something interesting like electric guitar, or you might use fiddle or something like that, just to keep the energy up right through the ending. Because a lot of times, as Michael knows, editors like to cut to the end of the song and use it as the out at the end of the scene.
They do.
And the ending of this song isn't really giving the editor much to work with. So even though it's got a nice button ending on the end, a really definitive end, it doesn't have the energy that editors like to use to really wrap up and nail the end of that scene as it fades to black. Those are the only things, and I don't think it would stop a library from taking this, or even a music soup from taking it.
I think it's really, really strong, and I want your opinion on a thought that I had. You know, in listings all the time, we mention ear candy, and it's mm-hmm. one of the more popular questions that we get. It's like, what is ear candy? It's hard to exactly define it, but I know it when I hear it, and we're trying to figure out ways to teach you guys to identify it. But ear candy in its simplest form is something, icing on the cake, salt and pepper, you know, on the steak. And I didn't intend for that to rhyme, but it's just that little extra something. Well, in this song, I think it's like a 4-5-1,
mm-hmm.
those notes. I'm gonna go back and just play that.
It's a little electro sound, and it's interesting.
Boom, boom, boom.
Yeah.
But that is a little sub hook in and of itself, and being placed throughout the song, it becomes ear candy.
That one,
right there.
Right there. Boom, boom, boom. And it's a nice sound.
Yeah.
It's a nice warm belly sound. That works well in this track, because even though the track is organic and acoustic, that little sound right there is electro, and it adds that indie folk element to it.
It's almost
indie element.
Like branding, you know, if mm-hmm. you were in your car and you heard that come by, you would go, oh, it's that song.
Mm-hmm.
It makes it so identifiable. So regarding what you said about the end of the song, I thought about taking unison vocals and having those in the last chorus on the out of the song, have unison vocals doing that to take the whole thing to another level, make it a little
could
more
do,
explosive
or could
or
sing,
empowering.
Sing that rhythm, but different notes on it to create a harmony part to that or something like that. But it does need something, I think, on the outro, on the ending, and in fact in the last verse. I would just layer something on top of it if you're still able to work on this song, if you've got a home studio. I would put something on the end. There is a guy online who does fiddle who's really, really good. It's $100 and you can go get him. there's all kinds of resources. If you want to do something, play an instrument that you don't play, there's some great players online who are inexpensive and really good.
A lot of these guys are actually doing it for each other.
I would definitely do that, yeah. Good. I noticed a lot of taxi members are starting, many more than used to, are now collaborating, which I'm really happy to see.
And doing it not only in the sense of collaborating as writers, but collaborating like I've got a song in my head that would be great for a guitarist to do, but I'm primarily a keyboardist, so they involve other members to play what they can.
Good.
And I'm not 100% sure, but I think that our next contestant, which is a song called Love Me From Far Away by Adriana Lucette and Nathan Nasby, I think for some reason that Nathan plays fiddle. I've had the pleasure of meeting him a couple of times. He was at the office right after the rally last year.
They're just making Nasby kills the fiddle, says Robbie. kills the fiddle. Yeah, there you go. Just saying.
Okay.
And there's Nathan. Lol, he says. You guys are fun to read. Why don't we just interview you? Okay. Yeah. So, and that's a great find. It's tough to find a good fiddle player, and if you can exchange in a little barter, a little trade, the more you can do that, the better, and I'm thrilled to see that. By the way, that reminds me of something I want to ask you if we can do at the Road Rally, because it's come up the last couple of years. When I bring up the idea that there are a lot of really good songwriters, top-line writers, looking for producers, and then producers will come by my table and say, yeah, but I'm looking for a songwriter, and I can't put them together because the songwriter came by earlier, and I can't remember who it is, and I can't find him again to put him together with somebody else. So if there was a place where they could drop their cards if they're a producer and drop their card if they're a songwriter looking for producers to top line with or something like
that? We have actually had meetings about this regarding this year's Road Rally. We've talked about it in the past, and we've never been able to come up with a way because of the sheer size of the crowd. We want to do it. So we're looking for suggestions. We're looking for an app that we could do it with. We're looking for a physical way we could do it. I mean, we've even thought about getting giant cork boards and putting them in the collaboration room, of which there will be a collaboration room at the Road Rally. And we've always had that, but it's going to be a little cooler this year.
I didn't
year.
Even know that.
So
so that's the place to do it, yeah.
The problem is you always get some dodo that walks in there and takes their, you know, card that's like this big or a one sheet, and they take a million thumbtacks and they put their thing on top of everybody else's.
We'll have to. There has to be somebody. Maybe somebody would like to volunteer to oversee that cork board or something, and just clean it up every night. One thing.
Well, we're trying to find a way to solve that problem. So, if you guys have any brilliant ideas that are really well thought out and you've poked your own holes in them, because we've been poking a lot of holes around here, please email it to memberservices@taxi.com, because we really want to offer that this year.
Excellent. Good.
Okay, so let's listen to the second
song.
Let's
move
along.
Well done, Clark. Nice work there.
By the way, I want to mention, Clark is an awesome guy who every year at the beginning of the rally, he works with Neil McTavish. Clark and Neil work together every year to help us get the banners up in the grand ballroom. And they're like clockwork, man. As soon as those things hit the ballroom, they're there to help us get the pipe and drape up in the banner. So I just want to give them a shout out for being awesome people and being so helpful.
Okay, so Adriana and Nathan, this is Love Me From Far Away.
It is.
Peace from a distance.
Absolutely gorgeous vocal, Adriana.
She can sing the phone book.
I know, I love her voice. And it's just perfectly suited for this type of song and some of the other ones that I've heard you sing. It's just right. Absolutely beautiful. Gorgeous production, Nathan and Adriana. Absolutely gorgeous production. Beautiful playing. It's, you know, you get into these 3-4 time songs and sometimes they can get very predictable. And this one never does. It's got a great melody that keeps flowing forward and really takes the listener along with it. It's just absolutely beautiful on a lot of levels. You could pitch this song as is And I think just on the strength of the mood that it creates, you would probably get interest in it. As a standalone song, featured underneath a montage or something like that, I think there's some things you want to look at in the lyrics. I also think it's too long. I think you were done when the fiddle came in the second time. I think that should have been the outro to the end. Didn't need another chorus on that.
Any idea what the we don't have any run times on it, but I'm curious. I felt it was a little long myself.
Oh yeah.
And when it got to the cute stuff at the end, the pretty stuff, the guitar work at the end,
mm-hmm.
I thought, I love that, but I wish it happened 20 seconds ago.
I loved every bit of it, yeah, but there's only so much you can do with a song that isn't really saying this. The issue for me was with the lyrics. There are three themes in this song, very clearly three different themes, and I can pick them out as we go. And the first theme is Love Me From Far, Far Away. Obviously, you're not here. But then we get into the second theme, which is I Can't Stay Here Tonight. Wait a minute, but I'm afraid to let this chance go by. Where did this come from?
Mm-hmm.
Because I thought they weren't together. So that's the second theme story. And then the third theme is I don't want to see this thing between us die, because I've got to admit that it's your love that keeps me alive. And we've never really talked about how this love keeps her alive, and so this becomes a third theme. And if you have three themes, then the listener can never go deeply into one single theme and feel it deeply. And one of the hallmarks of that issue is when I hear a line that says, love me from far, 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 far away. You're telling me what's happening, but you're not making the listener, me, feel what's happening. What is that distance? What does that distance feel like? What is that distance doing to your love? You can spend an entire song talking about distance. And what distance is, how cold it is, how the wind rushes between you, how you cannot reach across this deep gulf, how there's an ocean, there's a ton of ways to talk about distance. But instead of talking about distance after setting us up for distance, then you're going into different themes because I think you weren't sure what you were writing about. And this is not uncommon. I mean, we all do it. When we're writing, we don't step back ourselves and say get some perspective and mm-hmm. say, what am I writing about?
We're on the inside already.
Yeah, yeah, and you're writing beautiful lines. I'm not sure whether Adriana's doing the lyrics or you're both doing lyrics, but there are beautiful lines in here, and they're so seductive that you can seduce yourself into believing that you're writing depth when, in mm-hmm. fact, you're writing on a single plane. And you're just moving from one to the next instead of going deeper into the one single thing that is at the heart of the song. So you want to choose what it is that this song is about. And this is a killer song if you go to that place, which is distance and loneliness. And how do you overcome distance? Why did the distance happen? It's so fascinating. I mean, the opening is great. Why are you in my mind? You were so long ago. Why do I waste my dreams wishing for you? What an opening. Mm-hmm. It's magnificent. And it drew me right into the song and right into what was happening and the emotion of what's happening. And it's also a really universal emotion for many scenes in which people are not together, for whatever reason that is. And then we get into that game of unspoken truth, when I was the one for you. Beautiful. Continues right on. And then, but I never said a thing. I know you regret it too. That's the second verse. That's much further along than the listener is by that point. And those two lines hit me like, they pushed me away almost physically from out of the song, out of that wonderful place you had taken me into. And these two lines come along and they push the listener back. And that's what, as a songwriter, it's very difficult to feel. Because you, as the songwriter, know what it is you're saying and what you want to say. As a listener, I don't know where you're going. And so, as a listener, my response... When, as a listener who can verbalize that, I'm telling you that listeners will probably be pushed back by those two lines. So then you get into So Love Me From Far Away. Show me what you could never say. And that must be telling us what happened. Maybe this time we can make our peace from a distance, and then I got lost again. Maybe this time we can make our peace from a distance. Okay, but I think that those two lines need to be covered in the last two lines of your verse. You have to set those up there. What's happening? Are they reaching out to each other? Are they saying maybe we should? What's happening? So it's an issue of organization and also a thematic focus that would bring this gorgeous song into focus for the listener. I'd like to see you rework this verse and shorten the song and focus what the lyric is.
What would you guess the runtime is? I don't know if you saw the Kimberly post it. What would
you
guess?
Oh, did she? Didn't I? Didn't see it. 4.5?
5 minutes and 51 seconds.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
That would be my first clue as a producer in pre-production. I would say, okay, we've got a problem. We've probably got two songs here.
Yeah.
So just as a really pragmatic production tip, anytime you've got a song in pre-production and it's at tempo and runs, you know, 4.5, 5.5 minutes, start looking for ways to cut that sucker.
I can live with 4.5, and there have been hits at 4.5 even. But yeah, 5:51, 6 minutes.
Yeah,
unless it's
really
an event song. I mean, unless you are really going for the closing song on an album, and you have an event that you're singing about, something extraordinarily important.
Or the Olympics, maybe.
Yeah,
halftime.
I mean, you can do it. You can get away with 6 minutes, and people do for an album cut. But a Daughter does it. You know, I mean, Medicine is like incredibly long. That song. But you can do it. But it has to be a compelling reason to do that.
I've got to say, the line, that game of unspoken truth,
beautiful.
That's a song right there.
Yeah, it is.
That's
you're
a,
right.
a concept
he's,
for
yeah,
a song.
Yeah, he's right. There's more. There's concepts for three songs here, and they're all beautiful. I'm afraid to let this chance go by, so make the next move right now. I mean, it's gorgeous, but it has nothing to do with being far, far, far away. And when you say far, 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 I want you to change those lyrics and say, you are what? How does that feel? What is the gulf? What is the chasm between us? And tell the listener how that feels. Because
yeah,
I cannot reach you. You know, my arms are not long enough to go to where you are, to hold you where you are. I mean, something physical or something active or something image to give us that sense of distance, which is at the heart
about
of the song.
Where it hurts in your body.
Mm-hmm.
You know, specifics. You taught me that years ago.
Yeah.
Give me something specific that sounds general.
My arms cannot reach you. My arms are not long enough to reach you where you are far away. I mean, it's got to be physical.
I've got to slip a Donald Trump joke in there somewhere.
Okay. No, you don't.
The whole
no,
octopus thing.
Oh, that. Oh, my God. No, we don't
Sorry.
Have to go there. But beautiful, beautiful song. So much of this is beautiful. So you guys keep working on this because it's well worth it.
Yep.
Okay.
By the way, just the producer and me loved the acoustic guitar work. Beautifully recorded.
Yeah, Christine.
Great playing, and I'm guessing that you were kind of loose, whichever one of you played, kind of loose with the thumb and the finger, and it sounds just great.
It's perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah, the track is perfect. I don't want you to walk away from this song by any means.
Oh, one other production note that I make, because I tend to look at things as a producer. When we talk about intimate vocals, believable, authentic, intimate vocals in listings, that was such a terrific example of it.
Yeah.
And notice that Adriana built the intensity as the song moved along, but never lost the intimacy of it. And that's really hard to do because some people get almost Broadway-esque or operatic or something. When they go from intimate to bigger and more intense, they become very... and she didn't. She kept that intimacy.
Yeah, many times when we get more intense in our emotions, we become more restrained because we don't want people. It's an acting gig.
Yeah.
And she acted that song all the way through perfectly. There was never a false note in that song. And I'm sure you noticed that too. You all reacted the same way. It kept your attention for 6 minutes, which is kind of amazing.
All right, we're moving on. This one's called Underneath Your Spell by Hunter Mariano.
I will fall into your spirit. I will fall into your dreams. You got me underneath your spell. Underneath your spell. Carry my soul into your presence. Pure than gold. There's only perfection when I'm underneath your spell. Underneath your spell. I'm
It's interesting because the production, I like the production a lot. It's referencing a lot of rap. It's got a kind of a rap that's not particularly current. It's more of a Gangsta's Paradise kind of rap with the big strings in the background and the little hi-hat in the foreground and the big heavy sub kick. And I like that. It's a style that I like a lot, and it works well for a song that has a kind of a dark theme like this one does. But if you're going to do that, I think you need to take the production further in that direction and get probably a little bit more authentic with the rap genre in the production. Go ahead and just go all the way. There's a lot of good stuff in it already. And it's working pretty well. The lead vocal has the distort, the telephone effect on it, which works, is also rap, referential to rap, references rap. But I'm not sure the song has decided which genre it's in. It never breaks down into a rap. And it kind of stays at a single level from where it starts. It tells us that it starts with a chorus, which is another rap thing that rap does most of the time, starting with a chorus. I will fall into your spirit. I will fall into your dreams. You've got me underneath your spell. And one of the good things the lyric does is that it really has this palette of images that this stays pretty close, pretty tight. So when you get to verse one, we have, after having spirit in the chorus, spirit, dreams, spell, then when verse one, we get into hypnosis and mystery, illusion versus reality, deeper, under, spell. Again, we have a big palette of images. It's very, very tightly done, very well done. But unlike rap, it doesn't have the fresh imagery, the unexpected rhythmic twists in the melody. It just falls into this a kind of melody that's a little bit predictable. Dum, ba ba dum, bum, 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 bum. And you can get away with that for a certain amount of time, but then you kind of have to turn it around. You have to give it a twist so that the listener goes, whoa, wasn't expecting that. And that's true of the melody, and that's why they break these things up with a rap and do something that's got a lot of rhythmic interest and suddenly grabs your attention and puts pace in there.
This makes the case for the panel you're going to do at the rally about being contemporary, because the vocal is almost an 80s style vocal melodically. Mm. And when it executes the beginning, it kind of pulls you into this 80s vibe, and it's just dying to become more contemporary. Mm-hmm. Because of the rap production under. Mm-hmm. It, and it never brings the two together.
Yeah, there's a lot of potential in this song, a lot. And you could really, I don't know if you're with us or not.
Let's see, that was Hunter and Mariano.
Yeah, if you're with us. But there's a lot that you could do with this, because this track has tremendous potential. But you would want to look at some of the contemporary mixes of rap and melody that are out there, and take us deeper into, lyrically, you got to take us a lot deeper. You can't just sit on the surface with something like this. You say you take me, I'm under your spell. But what does that spell feel like? I'm sitting here as a listener. I feel like I'm on the outside, and the singer is telling me, I'm under this spell. I'm hypnotized. Why? You have to make me hypnotized too, and make me feel like what it feels to be under that spell. What does that feel like? What does it make you do? What kinds of things do you do? You can't hold back when you're writing a song, especially one with rap overtones like this one has. You have to take some real risks with the lyric and make us take us inside this relationship and inside what that makes you do, what it makes you feel like, and make the listener feel it too. Otherwise, you kind of get stuck. Again, this is another song that I felt was too long. I was surprised when it came back to it. It had a double chorus that didn't really build, and then it went to a breakdown, I think, and then it went into another chorus section, and there was nothing there. How is it that we can repeat choruses and keep the listener interested? I mean, we do it in all songs. Structurally, that's what we do. How is it that we can do that without boring the listener? And the only way to do that is that each time we come to the chorus, we know something more that makes it mean more to us as listeners. So we go, oh, wow, yeah, that's what that means.
Repeat that one more time. That was really valuable advice.
The reason we can get away with repeating choruses, which all songs do, is that the verse has to give us more information, or information in terms of how it feels, what it looks like, what it means, so that when we hear that chorus again, it means more or it means different, something different, so that it's new again each time we hear it.
Right.
And that's why it's not that you have to move the story forward, it's that you have to take us deeper into what it feels like and what it means. Then when we hear that chorus again, we go, oh, that's what that means.
It's
that's
really hard for songwriters to see something as objectively as listeners can.
Sure. By nature, by definition.
They created the story. They know what it is, so they're already informed.
Yeah, you know what it feels like, and we're not. We don't. So when I always use this example, which is that wonderful John Mayer song, Your Body is a Wonderful Land, Wonderland. Excuse me. Well, she knows what her body feels like. I mean, who he's singing to. He knows what her body feels like. And yet, the entire song is like this wonderful discovery of what her body feels like, because the listeners are discovering it. If you stop and think about it, it's like you're discovering right along with the singer what her body feels like. And that's what keeps that song fresh. And otherwise, I mean, the people involved, the singer certainly already knows all this. So that's the trick of being a songwriter, is to say things as if you're discovering it in the moment and take the listener with you. Be in that moment. And so when I hear a lot of cliches, or when I hear people writing the same thing in each verse, which is what's happening here also, when you're repeating the same thing in each verse, that tells me that you're not going into the situation in yourself. You aren't there. You're talking about it. And you know you want to say something, but you're not putting yourself back in that moment. And looking, close your eyes, be there in that moment that this happened to you. And look all around you and feel everything and put it in your body and say, what is this? What is it doing to me? Why does it feel so important that I talk about this? What do I need to say about this? Why do I need to say this to somebody else? Why? Why do we even bother to write songs?
You should create a checklist.
I think there is one in my first book.
Of ideas, questions to ask yourself that would prompt that drilling down.
Yeah, it's in my first book. It's called How to Never Write Another Cliché. And I probably have one in the film and TV book as well, yeah. Because writing clichés is avoidable, but it's always because we're staying on the surface, and we're writing the first thing that comes to our mind because we're either afraid to go deeper into it, or we don't know how to go deeper into it. And those are the things that drive a great lyric. And both of these songs we just looked at have tremendous potential, and yet the lyrics stop short of being the kind of thing. When you look at a writer like Rob Thomas from Matchbox 20 and also his solo stuff, when you look at him, your jaw drops. You know, a song as simple it'll come to me in a minute. His solo album is just amazing. When you sit and listen to Ever the Same, and he's talking about his wife and her cancer, being diagnosed with cancer, but you never know that, and you don't need to know that, because what he's talking about is any time that you and someone you love are faced with something that you have to battle, and it's brilliant. And when you look at that and you say, how did he do that? You go back to that moment and you relive it, and you relive it as vividly as you can. And then you try to express that in language that the listener can feel it the way you just felt it. And that's why we write songs.
It doesn't happen by accident. It doesn't happen by luck. And nobody's born that good. It happens because of repetition and evolving your craft.
Yeah, I read a wonderful interview with Jason Mraz in Recording Magazine, in M Magazine, and he said, I found that I was hiding. I was writing songs, all my first songs, I was hiding behind language. I was hiding from the listener. I didn't want to tell the listener what I was really feeling. I was hiding behind all this, and he does when you go back to those early songs, there's lots and lots of words. And he's dancing all around, and he's kind of hiding. He is. He's hiding behind the words. And he said, I finally realized I should stop doing that and just say what I mean and tell people what I feel and make them feel it too. And then that's when you start. Suddenly you get I'm Yours, you know, and that huge timeless hit.
The dichotomy is that so much of the beat-driven EDM-ish stuff that's out there in the charts right now, there is no depth, there is no drilling down, and they are hiding behind very simple lyrical concepts. So you kind of have to decide what kind of song this is.
This has to do, this. I thought a lot about that, because you bring up such a valid point, and people always ask me about that. There's two ways to approach EDM and club dance music, and one is that it's just there to make people's bodies move.
Right.
And so the lyric is strictly there to make your body aware.
It's almost an instrument.
You'll hear Lots of words that refer to physical, the mm-hmm. physical side of the body. And all that's all the dancers are getting. The dancers are hearing those words that are trigger words to make you feel your skin and your senses. And that, and you don't want to go any deeper into anything in order, because that's not where the people who are dancing right. to, it's not the use. Then you come across somebody like Lady Gaga, and you look at a song like Born This Way, which I was just looking at the lyrics to that the other day, and they're wonderful. My mother, my mom used to put her perfume on me in her boudoir. I mean, it's just a beautiful lyric lines. And Poker Face, and Just Dance. I mean, yeah. she rewrote the book on this. And then so did Katy Perry, and so did, these are real songs with real lyrics. And Kelly Clarkson, and they're well worth singing, and they're really well written. So if you aren't satisfied writing lyrics that basically say, feel your skin, feel your body, then you can look at those other writers and go that route with it, electro pop and electro dance with it, and you can be more satisfied with it. I think Ellie Goulding kind of, one of her Lights was one of her first singles, and I love that song. And then after that, I kind of lost track of her because she wasn't doing anything I was interested in. But what she's doing is writing songs that work real well for the use of dance floor.
Yeah, which is most of the time different than film and TV, which is what we're talking about here today.
Yeah.
But sometimes could be used as background source in
source
a club
music.
Or something.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Has to be, if it's a contemporary club, it has to be sound like it'd be something Ellie Goulding would write. Yeah.
So here comes a song called Here Comes Trouble by Angela Sheik. And this, the title alone, I think, lends itself well to film and TV. There's so many ways you could use that. Let's see how the song goes with it.
Here he comes, trouble come running down the street. Here he comes, trouble come running straight at me. Here he comes, trouble come running at top speed, straight at me. Here he comes, trouble come running. He's come this way before. Here he comes, trouble come running. Wanna pass at my front door. Here he comes, trouble come running. Can't take his company no more. Don't be fooled by his sense of pace. Pay no mind to his big eye and face. Don't be drawn by his silky eyes. Pay no attention to his smiling eyes. Ain't it clear? Ain't it plain as day? He used to have you on his plate. Don't stand the ground, don't stop to fight. Just turn around and run away.
Another song, there's another one, that track has a lot of potential. I love the sound. I love the sound. It does, it has a retro vibe. I think Nathan said something about that too on there. It does, it has a, the it pulls back towards, there was a movie a few years ago called The Triplets of Belleville, and it had a wonderful song in it called Rendezvous that had that kind of 20s harmony style, mm-hmm. the really tight three-part harmony with moving together. I really like the sound, I like the vibe of it. The verse and chorus seem too similar, so you end up kind of running into the same section over and over and over. I'd love to see it break out into something else for the chorus section. I like the what I think is the verse, "Don't be fooled by his handsome face, pay no mind to his beguiling ways, don't be drawn by his silky lies," that section. That really had the 30s feel to it, 20s, 30s feels to me. And then the repetition in the chorus seemed to be, "Here he comes, trouble comes running," just seemed to me to be a refrain line at the end of that verse rather than a regular chorus. It seemed to be missing some kind of a release. For film and TV, it could work for certain scenes because it's very specific. It's about a male. It's about somebody who's handsome. It's about a kind of a cheater and a rogue, which kind
a
of
playa.
Limits a playa. Yeah, it kind of limits the uses. So when you got into "He's Gaining Ground," "Best Put Your Burdens Down," "I Hear Him Breathing Now," which was much more open kind of, I am anticipating troubles of any kind that are, and I feel them heading my way. And I think the song would be better off, as far as film and television is concerned, if you took that approach to it, which is, there's trouble around the bend. I can feel it in the wind. It's coming towards me. I get this feeling now in my bones. And anxiety, an impending storm coming song, and in fact use something like the clouds, the storm is building, the seas are rising, I can feel it now, kind of thing, and keep it in a more metaphorical land than a specific male. And then film and television becomes a little more open to you. But as an album cut for you as an artist, I think it's a lot of fun. And I really like it. I think the vocal is excellent. And it's really very well done. It has a lot of unique qualities to it. I love that 20s, 30s style, If you would do more like that. I couldn't help thinking of the Imogen Heap song, "Hide and Seek." If you want to take a look at that, that's actually just vocoder, and that's all it is. It's just her with vocoder. And there's a couple of songs like that out there that have been used a lot in film and television that has really tight harmony. Mm-hmm. And they create a vibe, a very moody, kind of dark, troublesome vibe with that. And it works very well. And that song, "Hide and Seek," has been licensed a lot. And it's, in fact, it's a cappella. It's just vocal and herself singing with herself. It's really good.
I think the concept of this song, "Here Comes Trouble," mm-hmm. is so universal, so applicable to so many different types of films. And for some reason, I kept thinking just the concept alone, like in Home Alone. Mall cop, comedies would work really
trouble
well.
Trouble of any kind.
Yeah, not in the context of the way this lyric was written, but just the simple line, "Here comes trouble," and the beat and the tight harmonies. Mm-hmm. So personally, I would try and step back and just go, okay, if I were to start this all over, what could I do with that? Now that they've got your input,
because, the lyric,
there's something.
Start the
in
lyric
there.
Over, and then and give just a little bit more contrast between your chorus and your verses. And I would start with a verse, and I thought your suggestions were really good. Something like Home Alone, a fun comedy with a lot of slapstick in it and a lot of trouble, that kind of trouble, would be tons of fun with a song like this.
Yeah, you're not going to use it in a straight movie, in a drama. You're not going to have a song, "Here Comes Trouble." Yeah. It's got to be comedic.
Yeah.
Also, I have a question that's not necessarily related to this song, but how do you draw the line? Because you're teaching songwriting here in general sometimes, and sometimes we're looking at film and TV. How do you draw the film and TV side of songwriting? How do you draw the line between universal lyrics and lyrics in general songwriting that drill down, give more visual detail? It's a really fun, how do you know?
It's really, it took a long time for me to figure that one out. When I say physical detail and visual detail, it's not story detail. It's the kind of detail that says, this is how it feels to me. So an image like cold water is a good metaphor for cold feelings, mm-hmm. distance and loneliness, dark skies, you know, black, certain colors. Those are images of feelings, and they work as metaphors for feelings and similes for feelings. So Here Comes Trouble, for example, is a great metaphor for a feeling. But then when you put it on a male person and you say, oh, his handsome face and his this and his that, and that's the kind of trouble we're talking about in the world, that's the script writer's job. Mm-hmm. So I always look and see if I'm doing the script writer's job or not. And sometimes a song can do both. I mean, sometimes a music supervisor just, or a director or producer just loves a song so much.
Right.
And one of the verses works real well and the chorus works real well for film and TV, but the second verse is not as strong. For example, there's a wonderful song called Dark Hotel by K.S. Rhodes that I love. And it was used very effectively in a CSI Miami episode, and it's up full. In the last scene, as this woman is being walked off to jail, and she's realizing how awful her situation is, and the first verse of the song is it's obviously a relationship song, but the second verse of the song is just sorrow.
So they just use the second verse and the chorus
yep.
as the out.
Yep, and they use the whole thing, the whole second verse and the whole chorus and the whole, and it's mercy. Give me hope, give me just a little hope, give me, and that's the chorus. Mm-hmm. And the chorus is just this need to feel hope in the face of utter despair. And the second verse just describes despair in the sense of a dark hotel, a dreamer dying in a dark hotel, a coin rusting at the bottom of a well, of a wishing mm-hmm. well. I mean, it's just magnificent. And that, if you are that good and you can get the music supervisor to your second verse, you can get those uses. But quite frankly, I would like to have seen that be the first verse of the song because it's massive. But he was building. I mean, I could see that he was building and he was writing a song for his album. So,
right, which is that's the thing that I'm trying to point out, that writing for radio and records is very different from mm-hmm. this is why, and I didn't intend on plugging the book again, but I'm going to, which is why this book is so important.
Yeah.
Is because I think some people bought your first book and went, wow, this is amazing. This really upped my game. But this is a different discipline. Writing for film and TV is an entirely different discipline that uses some of the same techniques, but a bunch of different ones. And
what's interesting is how much stuff I'm hearing on the radio now that's film and TV friendly. I mean, button endings, definitive endings on all of it. Nobody's fading out anymore. Forget that. And that's been going on for a couple of years, and how emotional songs are now, and they're just pure emotion from beginning to end. We hardly get the situation, it's just like two lines and you're into the situation.
Yeah.
And when you listen to some of these songs that are huge hits on the radio, Heathens is just blew my mind away by 21 Pilots. I was listening to that
the
other
song.
Day. Yeah. It's a vibe song.
But
for, you know,
artists are well aware, major label artists are well aware that there are really only two ways they're going to make, well, three ways. Having a radio hit and making the performance income on those, having enough radio hits that they can sell out stadiums and make money on touring, and film and TV.
Yeah. And film and TV now, of course, feeds right into radio and records.
All right. This one is called I Wait for the Sun to Rise by Lawrence McGee.
Yeah, I'm talking about songs. Mojo Bone is saying, doing songs, not cues today. Oh, you're working on songs today? And it applies to, sure. I mean, but cues now are also, if you take the lyrics off some of these songs, if you take the vocals off some of these songs, they become cues. I mean, we do like to replace that vocal with something. We don't want to leave a big hole in the middle of a music bed. But on the other hand, the songs today are so emotional that when you take a look at those tracks, you're really looking at song that stuff that would work for cue music a lot of times.
I was actually writing something and I shared it with Robin yesterday via email. I was here at the office working on something for the Road Rally and sent her an email about how much of this book was applicable for instrumental stuff. Even though you didn't write it with that intent, you included a lot of that stuff. And
because you're doing the same thing. You're creating emotion.
Right.
Yeah. And
by
that's,
your choice of comes, chords, all
right.
kinds of things.
And the
rhythm.
Lyrics that you put on top are really just to enhance that emotion. That's why you have to think of film and TV songs a little bit differently. So, you know, if you strip the vocal off a Hozier song, you actually have a cue there. And it's kind of amazing.
All right, let's have a listen to I Wait for the Sun to Rise by Lawrence McGee.
Lay my head to rest tonight. Count your blessings when you sleep. For when you wake, your life is new. Love is all.
Absolutely gorgeous.
We didn't have a lyric sheet on this one, but did I hear the word bereft?
Yes, you did. And you heard blessings and tidings also.
And this
is a style. This is a genre, and I love this genre. You and I were listening to this before. And
what do you call the genre?
This is British folk rock, and it's very reminiscent of Fairport Convention and Fotheringay and Sandy Denny. I don't know how many of you are familiar with those artists. From the 60s, the British rock folk rock revival. Sandy Denny's Who Knows Where the Time Goes is one of the greatest songs ever written, I think. And that voice, this voice reminds me very much of Sandy Denny. I wouldn't be surprised if she's British, the singer. And there's a place for this, but it is a limited niche. And that's the downside of doing something like this. On the other hand, there is an audience for this in England that you would not believe. I hope you're thinking of releasing this in England, because there is an absolute fanatical cult around these bands from the 60s, and you have it nailed here. And those words, as soon as I heard blessings and tidings, I mean, those are trigger words for exactly what this is. The fact that it does not have a bridge, that it is, in fact, the structure of these classic British ballads. And her voice is just exactly right for this. I don't know who that singer is, but I absolutely adore her voice.
Her voice would be right for just about anything.
It's chills. It's chill time. Yeah, she's phenomenal. And, I mean, you could have her do Portishead stuff. You could do down-tempo chill with her, anything. But to do this, you're reaching out really to a niche audience for this that still exists and is bereft of singers and songs like this. And if you... I would think... I'm trying to think of... you probably... I don't know who... do we have Lawrence McGee with us? Are you here? Are you familiar with
raise
this?
Your raise hand, your hand, Lawrence.
Yeah, give us the virtual arm.
We can see you guys.
Yeah, and we're watching here.
Hopefully they're not giving us the virtual finger.
Yeah, we
just the arm. That's all yes. We want is the arm.
Okay, I don't see Lawrence, so I'm perhaps going to check in later. But you could pitch this as something like Rain, but Rain actually kind of moves away from this type
of thing. The TV show Rain.
The TV show Rain, R-E-I-G-N. But they tend to look for these things that are not that are anachronistic. They don't generally look for things that would actually fit with what they're doing. I would recommend, as far as production, beautiful playing on everything. The viola or the violin was magnificent, beautifully mournful. It was exactly right. Everything was played exactly right to evoke that sense of cold chill quality. I don't mean down tempo chill. I mean that sense that you get from British ballads of that deep, despairing fog that Brits do so well.
That's because the food they eat. I
mean, everything. It's just everything's a tiny little
boiled
island.
Boiled meat.
And they really get real depressed sometimes. And they love this music, and I love it too. I am absolute fanatic for this stuff.
We can't tell.
Yeah.
You're a little enthusiastic in a good way.
I love it. And I think that... it's worth doing, but it is a niche, and you'll have to find that audience for it. And I would definitely be looking to England to do it, to Britain, to find that audience.
I love
the only thing I would suggest is adding some kind of a pulse. Whether I think it's the drum is called a tambour, I think, and I would give it that.
Just keep it going. Are you talking about the big flat, round drum that's like 3 inches thick and about yay big?
Yeah, that thing. And it's really deep, it's real down, it's down very low, and you hear it in Irish music and British music. And it would add a pulse to the song that would pick up a little bit of the energy. On the other hand, if what you want is exactly this, then I think you've achieved a beautiful, sorrowful ballad in the British folk rock tradition.
I don't know if Lawrence McGee is also Larry McGee, but earlier today I was listening to some forwards that are going to a very high-end library that we recently started working with. And one or two of the tracks in the batch of forwards were from a gentleman named Larry McGee. If it's the same guy, you're very talented because your stuff, if you are the same Larry McGee that did the instrumental stuff today, it was really, really good. So great job.
Thank you. Good. Very nice. Really nice track. And it was a pleasure to hear that. And you know I'm a huge fan of British folk rock because I've done so much writing about Nick Drake and I've done so much studying of that time period and Joe Boyd is a friend and you know it's just a wonderful period of music from Britain.
Okay. All right, let's move on to what'll be the last one today, Solid Ground featuring...
Yes, we have somebody saying yes, he is Larry McGee, same person.
Oh, that's Kimberly,
same,
yeah.
Yeah, he's
cool.
The same person.
Larry is talented. Okay, so we're going to listen to Solid Ground featuring
recorder.
Kevin...
Somebody mentions recorder. That might also be nice to add if you want to build that a little bit more.
I had that thought, but I thought it would be too cliche.
It might be.
You almost expect to hear it.
Yeah, it might be. Good point.
Okay, Solid Ground. Here we
go.
This is number 6. Okay, good to go.
Oh, I can't.
I love her voice, especially the high register. Speaking of Ellie Goulding, she reminds me a lot of Ellie Goulding there. This turns it out to be a Christian song. You really understand that when you get to the longer spoken word section, call his name Jesus, he's all around. And then when you look back, you see that that's what it is. Each day is a gift, and I'm wasting it to the fullest without you. I can't live without you. I gained a life with you. You see that the whole thing really does lead there. I don't know whether, because this isn't, it doesn't look like this is intended to cross over, so I would probably bring that idea in earlier if that's what you're aiming for. It seems to be flipping between wanting to be a rap, a Christian rap, and wanting to be, it seems unfocused. She's got her, she opens it with a beautiful vocal, walking down the street, wanting forgiveness, each day is a gift, and that high Ellie Goulding style vocal is really beautiful. And then you hear the hey, and you really want to hear that rapper come in the contrast to her, and that doesn't happen. Mm-hmm. She goes lower on Because You Pick Me Up, You Turn Me Around, and her voice is not nearly as interesting down in the lower register as it is in the upper register. So I would have brought in the rapper right there, have her open the song, then bring in a rap with a lot more energy than this one has here. This is almost a spoken word rather than a rap, because it doesn't have the intricacies of the rhythmic intricacies that rap has. So I would push that a lot earlier. As soon as we hear that guy say, hey, then bring him in with, Because You Pick Me Up and Turn Me Around, My Life Is, you know, and then just start into a rap and use that phrase so that we know when you get to the end of the rap, use that section, what you're calling the chorus, Because You Pick Me Up and Turn Me Around, Place My Feet on Solid Ground, and have them sing it as a duet, an octave apart, and make that your refrain at the end of a rap. And it could, and bring in something underneath it to keep it interesting, because you have an 8x repeat there. And it's way too long to not have anything underneath that. You really need something there. So that's the structure I would be looking at, is something along those lines.
Do you remember Lauryn Hill?
Yeah, sure.
Am I crazy remembering? She did a lot of stuff that I felt at the time, I could never latch onto her, and all my colleagues thought she was the greatest thing since sliced bread. I just never got her. And do I remember correctly that she did a lot of stuff that was very arrhythmic? Am I thinking of the right artist or remembering?
Well, she did. I was just listening to Everything is Everything, which is off that first album.
Yeah.
And it's a mix, and it's a kind of rap, but it's less focused than what you would normally think of as rap, or it's neither fish nor fowl.
Right, that's how I felt about this. It's like either so sophisticated that I'm not getting it, or it's neither fish nor fowl and I'm not getting it.
I went back, I listened to Everything is Everything twice. The first time I went, what's happening here? And boy, the second time I put it on, it really locked.
Yeah.
And I really got it. So I would take a look at something like that, those tracks that she did on that first album, and see if you want to use a structure. Her structure is very loose. Yeah, it's very loose. And you can't really say for sure this is a rap or this is,
right,
you know, Lauryn Hill singing. And I think there was an expectation on that. But she's going so deep in the lyric that it's so moving, and her vocals are so moving, that she's really getting away with it. And I think you have the potential to do that here if you want to.
That's what I was feeling.
Between these two voices. I like that rapper's voice. It's a high voice, but I would like to hear the rap written in a more staccato style with more rhythmical interest so that he really gets your ear going. And then you can smooth it out and go into the... And she does that. There are real raps in there, and then she smooths it out and goes into the Everything is Everything. And you could do that then with Because You Pick Me Up and Turn Me Round. With that, I would say Pick Me Up, Turn Me Round is not as interesting as it needs to be. It's not as compelling as it needs to be. But it could work if it's coming in as a refrain at the end of a very intricate rap. You'd be grateful for the break.
I would almost look at Lauryn Hill and then go backwards to the Fugees and look, the guidance you need is in there, but go backwards.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. Yeah, I think it's a very good idea. Take a look at that whole area.
Yeah, they were more commercial and more accessible than she was, but it was all from the same kind of ballpark, obviously.
There's a ton of talent here and potential here. I really like this track,
yeah,
a lot. And I like a lot of the elements that are in it, vocally, in terms of the track, in terms of the feel, in terms of the message, all of that. But you need to really take a look at some reference tracks. And this is one of my favorite things. This is my thing, my rant lately, is reference tracks. I want to see people referencing more. If you're writing something like this, and I can feel that you're going from your heart, it's just coming straight out and onto the, you know, into the digital land world, and you're recording it, this is a great first draft to get your heart on the page. Then take that and go, what world is this coming from? What can I learn from people who have been in that world before me? Mm-hmm. Too often we reinvent our world, and there isn't enough time to reinvent what has been invented before you. There just isn't. Life is too short. And when when you're young and you're just full of ideas and all you can do, it's everything you can do just to get them down and record it, that's one thing. But once you've done that and you've gotten a lot of stuff out there, you know, for heaven's sakes, go back to Lauryn Hill and go back to the Fugees and look at what they found that connected with listeners.
Yeah.
Because the Fugees really did. And that's what you're saying.
Right.
Lauryn Hill doesn't immediately connect, although eventually...
The Fugees hadn't probably wouldn't have caught on.
You're exactly right.
But she was the more sophisticated, more interesting, let's break some rules and take it to another level version of the Fugees. And this needs to go back to the Fugees, because this is trying to do that same thing that Lauryn
Hill did. To break ground on your own, And I think you would find that you would find some techniques in those songs that you could apply to your song without ending up sounding like the Fugees or anybody else but you.
Yeah.
Is take techniques that you find in reference songs that can solve problems for you and say, oh, I could use that technique. I could use that transition idea. I could use that. And then do it, but do it your way. And you'll end up sounding like you. Too often we don't use the solutions to problems that are right in front of us in our favorite artists.
Speaking of going back to that era earlier, like a couple songs ago, I think it's two songs ago, Keith LeBrant said that one of the artists reminded him of Fisher. And I went, oh yeah, Fisher. Do you remember, were you around here? Okay, the artist's name was Fisher, the band name was Fisher, but it was really an artist named Kathy Fisher. And she was the very early days of the internet. She was a taxi member, and I put her on a taxi compilation to give out to people in the industry. I was playing golf with my friend Tony, who's the VP of A&R.
Tony.
Yeah, Vice golf, President of Interscope. I can't believe I can't remember his name. Anyway, at the end of our round of golf, we were in the parking lot, and I handed him a CD and said, would you do me a favor and listen to this taxi compilation and tell me what you think of the order? And he called me from his car, and he said, that girl Fisher should be the number one song. And is it okay if I call up, I can't remember who the president was of Interscope. It wasn't Iovine. He was chairman, I think. Anyway, can I call them, play it for them, blah, blah, blah. She ended up getting signed as a result of that golf game. But her publicist and manager quickly grabbed a hold of the story that she was the biggest thing on the internet. And of course, Taxi got shoved under Anyway, I'm surprised that you knew who she was, Keith. That was a good call. Very, very talented artist. So
yes, and Miseducation was the album we were referring to.
Lauryn Hill.
That's the one that has everything in it, is everything on it.
Yep. All right. Well, all right. So are you ready for the rally? Do you have your whole thing? Because if you think Robin is good at this on the fly, you should see what she does at the road rally when she's actually prepared and gone over it, nitpicking herself to death when she walks on that stage. I could leave the room for an hour and go see other things. I stay in there and
he
watch
does,
Robin.
Which I really appreciate. Yeah. Yeah, no, I'm in the middle of choosing examples to play for you to make you laugh and make you cry and make you go, oh, I could do that. So, it's all about references, and I'm always looking for references. It's why I listen to music, and so that's what I'm doing right now, is I'm getting my references together to play for you and say, oh, look at that, look at what they did, oh my God, you could do that.
She told me, I'm not going to give anything away, but she did tell me about one that she's going to do, and the way it contrasts the old and the new, it'll blow
you'll
your
laugh.
Mind.
Yeah. You'll laugh.
And not only will you laugh, but you'll walk out of the room going, oh.
I could do that.
Yeah, now I get it.
Yeah, I got it.
Let's see. Do I have anything else I want to mention to you guys? Next week, we will have Ronan Chris Murphy, engineer producer on the show.
Oh, he's great, yeah.
Everybody loves him. I mentioned the hotel. Yeah, get your hotel rooms now. And the listings, seriously, please read the emails of the listings. We are putting out so many great listings lately.
Just I read them every day.
Killer listings.
Yeah, and I look at the reference. I have a whole list of playlists that come from your listings. I pull the artists out of them and I put them in my playlist. This is R&B or what was the anthemic rock the other day? And there were some really interesting things and subject. I just pulled a couple of those out. Immortals by Fall Out Boy was referenced in there. And I went, listen to it, and I used it immediately to play it for somebody else and say, this is what you need to do with that chorus of your song, and here's how they do it. So just for playlists alone, open those emails and grab the references, because the guys who do those references have put a lot of work into them, and you don't have to do it because they did it for you.
We spend a spectacularly great, just huge amount of time working on the references, and I know that people get frustrated. It's like, I don't get it. Should I be just like the references? Or, you know, we try to tell you. We'll say things like, within the wide range of. It's extremely rare that they want you to sound just like the references.
Yeah. You want to take the vibe. You want to get the vibe. And that's what I'll show you, is we'll go through some songs and I'll show you, here's what you could use. Here's the groove. Here's the energy. Here's the how you could create that in general. And then you just take that generality and you make it your specific, you know, and then you end up with something that has a similar vibe but doesn't sound the same. And thank you, by the way, for all the nice compliments. I'm reading that. Thank you.
I want to mention, Sunday morning, we're doing a thing that I don't think we've done in probably 15 years of the Road Rally, which is Ask Taxi Anything. And I've done Taxi TV's Ask Michael Anything, but we're taking two of our very best screeners and the folks who write the listings at Taxi and come up with those references. And basically, it's going to be a hangout where it's going to be more of a conversation than a panel. But we're doing this in an effort to find out what we can do to better serve you guys. We want to know, is there something we think is cool in the way we write listings that you think we could be doing better? Anything like that. So start jotting down ideas and plan on being in the ballroom at 9:30. I know this is tough, but 9:30 on Sunday morning on November 6th. I know people are going to be up on the hotel roof partying on Saturday night, but this is going to be important, and it's really going to determine to some extent the future of the company, the direction that we go in. So we really want you in there, and we want your feedback. Also, I want to mention one other thing, which is, where did it go? By the way, have I mentioned that Keith LeBrant is the John Brahaney Award winner this year, which I'm very, very happy for him. He so richly deserves that. Last year, you guys know I was heartbroken that not more people were in the room when I had Frank Palazzolo in there.
Oh, he's great. He is great. I was in the room for that.
And so I'm bringing him back this year, and
he's
we're going to do that plus like a 30% improvement on that. And that's going to take place from 2:30 to 3:30 on Saturday afternoon. So I'm telling you, this road rally, it's just going to be great. That, you guys know me well enough to know it ain't hype. It's fact. So show up, damn it, November 3rd through the 6th, Los Angeles, California. And with that, thank you, Robin.
Oh, thank you.
Amazing
thank you
as
all,
always.
Everybody. Thank you for being so wonderful.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Keep the great music coming.
We will see you next week for another exciting episode of Taxi TV. And I will see you in 2 weeks at the Red Rally. Bye-bye, you guys.
2 weeks.